That's who's there. Carried me back to old Virginia.
The John Rolfe Pocahontas marriage had an instant and profound impact upon the Jamestown colony and Virginia's future. Soon after their union was complete, hostilities between the Powhatan Confederation and the English ceased, and the Chickahominy tribe also sent ambassadors to firm up an alliance with the English. They even went so far as to submit under King James' rule and become known as Tassantasses themselves, or strangers, just like the Englishmen. Their submission came with various strings. They could not attack the English, warriors must be supplied in case of a Spanish attack, and 1,000 bushel corn tribute was to be given to the English. The Chickahominies received trinkets, such as King James' picture engraved in copper and hung on a necklace, newer iron tomahawks, and English protection from a potential Powhatan invasion. War between the English and the natives was thus ended, at least for the time being, and English Virginia entered a somewhat new era, one of solidifying existing settlements, as well as building new ones.
Oh, the desert dreams of a river that will run down to the sea, like my heart longs for an ocean to wash down.
Thomas Dale presciently recognized his new position and decided to take further steps to increase his power. To do so, Dale sent Rolfe Haymore, the newly appointed colony secretary, along with the young interpreter Thomas Savage, to meet Powhatan at Oropax, his new capital. Powhatan knew Savage very well, because Savage spent many years under Powhatan's care just after he arrived at Jamestown in 1608. In fact, the paramount chieftain stated that he missed his young friend and somewhat chided Savage for not returning to visit for 4 years. But almost as soon as Savage and Haymore were warmly received by Powhatan, the mood shifted. Where was Namontack, the boy exchanged for Savage years ago? It seems that Powhatan had never heard that Namontack killed his companion Matchumps, or that he had converted to Christianity while in England. It's odd that Powhatan knew nothing of either event, considering how well informed he was up to this point. Next, Powhatan reached into Haymore's shirt to feel for something that he was supposed to have had around his neck, a pearl necklace. For you see, the first time that Powhatan and Thomas Dale met, the chieftain gifted a pearl necklace to Dale with a request that any Englishman visiting Powhatan in Dale's name was to wear the pearls. Haymore didn't have them, but Powhatan let the matter slide, this time at least. After exchanging news and pleasantries, the matter for which Dale and Savage traveled to Powhatan was discussed. Thomas Dale's purpose in sending the two men was to ask for another of Powhatan's daughter's hands in marriage. This was an odd request, for at least two reasons. One, Dale was already married, and thus would be breaking very strict Anglican laws on marriage. And two, Dale was perhaps 20 years older than the desired 11-year-old Powhatan daughter. Haymore and Savage made Dale's request and presented gifts to show how serious Dale's intentions were, but Powhatan wasn't impressed. He rejected their offer while reinforcing his friendly intentions. He wanted peace. Too many lives were already lost. No more needed to die. In fact, Powhatan said, "I will remove myself further from you." During the night after this initial meeting, one of the English runaways, William Parker, visited Haymore and Savage. He wanted to return to Jamestown with the Englishmen, but when they asked Powhatan, the chieftain became livid and would not resume meeting with Haymore and Savage the rest of the day. Later the next night, after Haymore was already asleep, Powhatan came calling. He was no longer angry and had a list of things that he wanted from the English. Copper, a grinding stone, a tool to cut wood called a fro, bone combs, fish hooks, and somewhat endearingly, a cat and a dog. Now there's an amusing picture. Imagine the 70-year-old Powhatan sitting amidst his entourage petting a cat that was curled up on his lap. Powhatan fed the men well the next morning and clothed them with newer buckskins, as well as bestowed gifts for his daughter and son-in-law. Then he offered one last statement to Dale. He hoped that their friendly relations would remain, but if they wouldn't, then Powhatan would move 3 days' journey westward and never see another Englishman again. In fact, we don't know if he ever did see another Englishman, and these were the last recorded words that we have from Powhatan. His power drastically diminished between 1614 and his death in 1618. By that time, his brother, a somewhat weak leader, Opechancanough, became the Confederacy's new Mamanituik. However, the real power would lie with the younger brother, Opechancanough. Either way, the Powhatans' power had certainly weakened, and they had indeed already been pushed westward more than once as Powhatan had moved his capital from Werowocomoco to Oropax before finally resting in Matchut on the northern bank of the Pamunkey River in modern King William County. Whether Dale would marry Powhatan's 11-year-old daughter or not had no bearing on the colony, because 1614 Virginia, though not perfect, was a colony on the rise. No silver or gold was found, the Northwest Passage wasn't found either, and to date, Jamestown was never used to mount an attack into Spanish territory. Further, as we've seen so far, Virginia was a hot and cold cauldron of death and disease. But one man's many great misfortunes, shipwreck, wives, and child's deaths, did not stop his determination. Oh, won't you take me from this valley to that mountain high above? Oh, I will pray, pray, pray till I see your smiling face. I will pray, pray, pray until I love. John Rolfe is believed to have been born to John and Dorothea Mason Rolfe in May 1585, though we can't know with any certainty, and the extant records do have a few unexplainable holes. Beyond that, history doesn't record much, if anything at all, regarding Rolfe's early life. In fact, Rolfe is a relative nobody until he boards the fateful 1609 Sea Venture voyage doomed to run aground on Bermuda. While there, Rolfe's wife, possibly one Sarah Hacker Rolfe, gave birth to their only child, a daughter that they named Bermuda. But neither mother nor daughter survived their time in Bermuda, leaving Rolfe to complete the 1610 journey to Virginia alone. At some point, Rolfe picked up seeds for the much-sought-after Spanish tobacco that the English market so craved by the 1610s. These were certainly difficult seeds to obtain, and a few theories abound as to how Rolfe obtained these precious seeds, among which two predominate. One theory has Rolfe and his fellow Sea Venture survivors cultivating Spanish tobacco planted by previously shipwrecked Spaniards on Bermuda. When Rolfe made his way to Virginia, he brought a few seeds to plant in his new home. The other theory is that Rolfe somehow purchased seeds from a shipmaster who spent time in Trinidad. This was a risky proposition in that the seeds were sole property of the Spanish Empire. Thus, selling such a lucrative crop to an Englishman could have been a potentially fatal sale. Some have speculated that Rolfe cultivated the native Virginian tobacco smoked by the Powhatan tribes. But this strain was much weaker than the Spanish version, and it had a nagging bite at the end that the English did not like. So this lesser theory appears to be the least likely path Rolfe used to introduce the sweet-scented Orinoco strain found in the Spanish colonies. For my thought, I believe it most likely that Rolfe was introduced to the Orinoco strain during his time on Bermuda, because the three Sea Venture survivors who remained behind after the Patience and Deliverance sailed away in 1610 also began growing the highly sought-after tobacco strain. By the time the Virginia Company decided to patent Bermuda in 1612, and settlers started populating the island, the three Sea Venture settlers had already figured out how to grow the Orinoco strain properly. Meanwhile, Rolfe also began figuring out how to grow Spain's prized tobacco in Virginia, perhaps at Jamestown. But he also could have experimented with the weed at Bermuda Hundred, about 4 miles south of Henrico. Rolfe and the Virginians had much to learn, but they did manage to ship an approximately 1,200-pound tobacco crop back to England aboard Captain Robert Adams' ship Elizabeth on July 20, 1613. The crop wasn't as premium as that grown in the West Indies, but it did have great potential, as Rolfe knew, and he believed that further experimentation would allow him and his compatriots to zero in on the proper growing and curing methods necessary. Seeing the potential in Rolfe's work, many Virginia settlers also began planting and experimenting with tobacco. The first known recorded plantation to grow the weed was Weston Shirley Hundred, just across the James River from where Rolfe potentially grew his first crop at Bermuda Hundred. The move to grow tobacco on Thomas West, Lord Delaware's land, sparked the Virginia colony into life, as settlers who were just now being granted increasing freedom and private property rights began clearing and bringing land under their dominion. The age of Virginia's James River Plantations now dawned. West and Shirley Hundred, arguably, to some, the first Virginia plantation, today known simply as Shirley Plantation, was founded by Thomas Dale in 1613. The details surrounding the plantation's founding are sketchy, but some agricultural activity certainly did take place on the grounds of the Western Hemisphere's oldest continual business soon after settling the land. The tobacco planting on Bermuda Hundred and Shirley Plantation sparked a settlement boom that shifted Virginia's focus upriver between 1612 and 1616. Other lands associated with what was collectively known as Bermuda City were also founded in 1613, as well as plantations at nearby Curl's Neck, also then known as Upper Hundred, Coxendale, adjacent to Henrico, and Diggs His Hundred. A Bermuda city itself was also planned during this time, and it was to be an impregnable fortress that would come alongside and then soon take the place of James City, Kecoughtan, and even Henrico. Dale's goal was to shift Virginia's focus up the river. And to do so, he attempted to ensure the city's success by using the newly relaxed land grant system as bait. He promised the colonists attached to the Bermuda Incorporation that if they served at Bermuda City for 3 years, then they would receive their own lands at the end of their contracts. Their 3-year terms ended in 1617, at which time Samuel Argall was now governor. Dale had returned to England aboard the Treasurer in 1616. Argall, also a contract member, promised to fulfill the contractual obligations established under Dale. This move served to shift Virginia's population center back down the James River, as Argall desired in contrast to Dale's plan. Thus, an even larger land grab between 1616 and 1622 began, as more than 30 plantations carved up land along the James River and into the eastern shore. Initially, everyone received 50 acres, but that number was soon increased to 100 acres for the groups of the earliest surviving settlers known as the Ancients, thus the ever-present term hundred that was attached to most of the plantations. Others who paid money up front to sponsor a settler's passage across the Atlantic were also eligible to receive these 100-acre plots. Therefore, within a relatively short time span, Virginia transformed from a fledgling, almost dead colony in 1610 to a still fragile but vibrant network of more than 40 plantations and 4 city centers, James City, Bermuda City, Kecoughtan, the site of Fort Algernon that was eventually renamed Elizabeth City, and Henrico. All of this was made possible in part because of John Rolfe, the one-time historical nobody who dared to tempt fate, survive death on multiple occasions, successfully obtain and plant a desirable tobacco strain, and marry a Powhatan princess. He was now most certainly an historical somebody, a somebody who was looked at with adoring eyes in England, and as such, Rolfe and his legendary wife were desired to be used as advertising for Virginia back in England. For the outcast, dreams of acceptance, just to find pure love's embrace. Like a mother longs for its mother, or may you. The still somewhat newly wedded couple, who now had a young son named Thomas, made plans to travel to England in 1616. Rolfe wanted to tout his tobacco venture, while the Virginia Company wanted to tout his wife. Pocahontas, known in English courtly society as Lady Rebecca, captivated the English nobility. She was an exotic beauty, the girl, now woman, who saved John Smith's life, converted to Christianity, and married an Englishman. She made her rounds through Upper English society during the almost year spent in England. Pocahontas even attended a masquerade sponsored by the great English playwright Ben Jonson, and was the guest of King James and Queen Anne. Oddly enough for modern sensibility, Rolfe was not invited, or even allowed to attend the party, as he was not part of the upper circles of English society. In fact, Rolfe could have been put to death for marrying above his station, a very serious crime in 17th century England. While in England, Pocahontas was also reunited with a ghost from her past. After several months of engagements, Pocahontas and Rolfe were visited by John Smith at their new home in Brentford. The meeting was tepid. Pocahontas and the Powhatans had been told for 7 years that Smith was dead. Now here he was, standing before her in the flesh. The occasion must have been too much for her, because she turned and hid for a couple of hours before finally returning to awkwardly talk with Smith. Though this meeting wasn't a great success, the young Rolfe family proved to be a hit, even if Pocahontas' native Virginian retinue did not like England's smoky, dirty civilization. More importantly, though, the Virginia Company continued to survive, especially due in part to the Rolfes' visit. But the smoky, dirty civilization did seem to take a toll on the Indian princess, because as plans were being finalized to sail back to England, Pocahontas fell ill. It seemed that her sickness wasn't viewed too seriously at first, but when the George started down the Thames and had neared Gravesend, it became apparent that she wasn't faking. Perhaps an assumption, because Pocahontas really did want to stay in England. Rolfe and Argall realized, all too late, just how serious the illness had become, and suspended their journey, but only long enough for Lady Rebecca to sadly pass away from what many believed to have been tuberculosis. She died on March 21st, 1617, while comforting her husband. "Almost die. 'Tis enough that the child liveth." But the child, Thomas, was also ill, and Rolfe had to make a tough, unpopular decision. He felt that Thomas wasn't well enough to make the long journey across the Atlantic, and instead of burying his 2-year-old son at sea, Rolfe chose to leave the toddler in Lewis Stuckley's care while Rolfe's brother Henry arrived to take the child under his guardianship. John would never see Thomas again. An interesting side note here. Stuckley was the main driving force behind Sir Walter Raleigh's death in 1618. He had accompanied Raleigh on the 1617 Orinoco expedition that returned to England empty-handed. Stuckley put a plot into motion in which Raleigh was betrayed by a feigned Stuckley friendship on August 9, 1618. Later, when Stuckley's actions were discovered, a campaign was launched against Judas Stuckley for what he had done. Rolfe returned to Virginia, where he continued to lead the tobacco revolution, the very same revolution begun by Sir Walter Raleigh many years earlier. But the 1616 English journey affected another outcome. Pocahontas's entourage, specifically Tomocomo, returned with a bitter taste in his mouth. He hated how filthy England was, did not like how the English treated the Indians, and railed against his, quote, best friend, Thomas Dale. The comments were downplayed by the English at the time, but Tomocomo shared his thoughts with Opecancano, Powhatan's powerful brother, and those comments seemed to have hit their intended target, as would soon be seen. Virginia, largely due to John Rolfe's work, but more importantly because of private property's introduction and entrepreneurial encouragement, was certainly on the rise after Rolfe returned in 1617. Yet the colony still had to endure hard times, especially after Pocahontas and then Powhatan died in 1617 and 1618, respectively. Eventually, the hearer of Tomocomo's complaints, Opecancano, came to power. His reign continued the era of peace for a time, but that all changed one fateful March 1622 morning.
Dreams of a strong wind that will float beneath her wings like a voice lost.
Thank you again for supporting the podcast. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to continue growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to help expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you haven't done so yet, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. If you would like to do more, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPod. to see the choices and rewards being offered. And please, join us next time as I begin outlining the growth of the historic James River Plantations. Do 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 do